Please stand with me for the reading of God's word. Isaiah 9:6. For a child is born to us, a son is given to us. The government will rest on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace.
Amen. Thank you, Kaylee. You may be seated. She did a great job, didn't she? She was so nervous. Nothing to be nervous about. Kaylee did a great job. And I called her by her right name. Some of you understand, like, I call her Charlie. And when we first moved here, I'll tell you the story. Why do I call her Charlie? Well, when we first moved here, I couldn't remember her name. And when I saw her one time, I said, "Hey, Charlie." And she just looked at me. I was like, "That's not your name, is it?" And she said, "No." And I said, "Well, guess what? That's your name from now on." So, Charlie, you did a great job. And she was, when I asked her last night if she would read for me, she looked at me and goes, "Actually?" I was like, "Why not?" Anyway. Hey, but doesn't it look good up here? I mean, I know I do. Thank you, Carl. But I'm talking about the decorations. Doesn't it look good up here? There was some volunteers that spent approximately 62 hours up here doing it. That might be a little exaggeration. Give or take a few. They asked me not to tell you their names, and I said I would respect that. But I will tell you that it starts with an S and a G. I didn't tell you their names, but I'm getting the death glare. But they did a phenomenal job, and I want to tell them from the bottom of my heart, yeah. I will say, though, if you come up here to take pictures, okay, you should, don't touch this tree, okay? This tree right here needs to be prayed over. It's got a little bit of a, I'm not looking over there, sorry, a little bit of a, yeah, just, you know, it needs Jesus, all right? And it's got a little short in it, and we're just going to pray it through. But we think we got it. They think they got it fixed, so we'll just go with that, right? But it looks good. And so you're wondering, why are the lights turned out? Well, here's the thing. And you ever been to a movie theater and the lights go out? When the lights go out, what do you do? You focus up front, right? Right. So the focus is what I'm trying to get you to do is focus up front. What's up front? Not me. Is this, right here. This is what I want you to focus on, right? This right here, this little manger right here is the entire focus of this season. Because if we don't have this, you never have the cross, right? Without the beginning, you never have the end. So that's why the lights are a little turned down. I want you to begin. My whole basis of all this is I'm big on why. I don't want to do something in a church just to do it because it looks cool. Man, it looks great. Now, I'm not going to lie. I think it looks great. Props to the awesome people who did it. I want to help you understand in my brain why we're doing the things that we're doing. Well, there's that young pastor again wanting to come in here and change everything. That's not the purpose. So you can go and get that thought out of your brain. And if you have that thought, come talk to me. I will gladly let you in my ADHD brain. And then you'll go home thinking, wow, I should have never done that. Whew. I am more confused now ever than I was when I went to talk to him. And then I will then say, welcome to my life. Right? But I want to tell you why. We're doing this because we're focusing this whole season on this. On sweet baby Jesus. He may have worn golden diapers, I don't know. Probably not. This series, Jesus Is one of my all-time favorites. I did this series, I think, 4 years ago, you're thinking, well, 4 years ago, you're a kids pastor. Well, guess what? This is a kids series. Wait a minute, you're not shocked. Do you realize all my series I've done here have been kids series? But I love this because we're going to look through that verse of Jesus is. What is Jesus? And we're going to look at the prophecy of what Isaiah wrote and what Kaylee just read. Jesus is Wonderful Counselor. Jesus is Mighty God. Jesus is Everlasting Father. Jesus is Prince of Peace. This verse was written hundreds of years before Jesus was even born into that manger. And it raises the important question, why did Isaiah deliver this prophecy so long before Christ's arrival? And so today we're going to look, even before we get to Jesus' Wonderful Counselor, we're going to look at just a glimpse of the historical context of Isaiah chapter 9. Now, here's the deal. I want you to stick with me through this. Because I went back and I studied a lot of history. And I think if you don't understand the background of where Isaiah wrote this prophecy, if you don't understand the historical context of this, you don't really get why he wrote it. Because in the midst of all this, it's chaotic at this time. Do you realize that? Like, it's chaotic. But Isaiah gives them hope. He gives them hope. And so Isaiah 9 is set against the backdrop of political turmoil, spiritual decline, and external threats during the 8th century. Guess what? Does that sound familiar? Let's put our century there, right? This was during the 8th century BC. And so understanding this historical context of Judah and his surrounding nation sheds lights on the significance of this chapter. And so we have the historical context of this. The time frame of Isaiah's ministry. Isaiah prophesied during the reigns of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, Hezekiah, primarily focusing on the southern kingdom of Judah. Isaiah 9 likely dates to the reign of Ahaz in the 735 to 715 BC, a time frame in national crisis. Assyria under Tiglath-Pileser III was the dominant superpower, expanding aggressively across the Near East. Both the northern kingdom of Israel and the southern kingdom of Judah felt pressure from the Assyrian expansion. The fear of evasion was pervasive. And then you have the Syria-Ephraimite War that took place in 735 to 732 BC. Israel, the northern kingdom, and Aram, which is Syria, allied to resist the Assyrian domination and sought to force Judah into their coalition. But King Ahaz and Judah refused to join them, prompting Israel and Aram to threaten Judah with military. So in response, Ahaz sought aid from Assyria, paying a heavy tribute and making Judah a vassal state. Now, you can read that. If you don't believe me, you can go read it in 2 Kings chapter 16. Then you have Judah's spiritual and political climate at this time. Spiritual decline, as I said earlier. Judah was in a state of moral and spiritual corruption. The people worshiped idols, ignored God's covenant, and trusted political alliances rather than in God's protection. Again, does that sound eerily familiar? King Ahaz himself embraced idolatry, even offering his son as a sacrifice to pagan gods. Again, go read it. 2 Kings chapter 16, again. I would urge you, go read this. Then you have the political instability. King Ahaz's decision to align with Assyria provided temporary relief, but weakened Judah's independence and trust in God. This reliance on foreign powers was seen by Isaiah as a lack of faith and trust in God's sovereignty. And then we see the literary context of actual Isaiah 9. You have the prophet narrative. Isaiah 9 is a part of a larger section. You have Isaiah chapter 7 through 12, often called the book of Emmanuel. These chapters focus on God's judgment on faithless leaders and nations and promise of future deliverer. Isaiah 7, the prophecy of Emmanuel, meaning God is with us, is given to King Ahaz as a sign of God's presence and protection. Isaiah 8, the chapter warns of the Assyrian invasion, likened to the flood sweeping over the land. Then you have the transition to hope, right? That's where, despite the judgment in chapter 8, guess what? You have hope in chapter 9 with the promise of light breaking into darkness. It points to the future ruler who will bring peace and justice and restoration. The contrast emphasizes that God's judgment is not the final word. Hope and salvation remain for the faithful. Then you have the key historical elements of Isaiah chapter 9. You have verse 1, it says, Galilee of the Gentiles, right? The region was among the first to suffer the Assyrian people during the campaigns of 732 BC. The mention of Galilee highlights the devastations, but also promises that the region will witness the coming of the great light. Then you have verse 4. It says, the yoke of the oppression. The imaginary reflects on the burdens of the Assyrian domination and the broader oppression faced by the people. The prophecy promises liberation, much like the deliverance from Midian under Gideon. Again, Judges chapter 7. Then you have verse 6 of Isaiah chapter 9. The child and his rule, right? The promise of a child symbolizes hope for righteous. God anointed king contrasting the failures of Ahaz. And so while this may initially been as seen as a reference to Hezekiah or other contemporary figure, the prophecy ultimately transcends its immediate historical context, pointing to the ideal ruler. And then you have the Assyrian domination and prophetic hope. Assyria's role in God's plan. Isaiah presents Assyria as an instrument of God's judgment and faithless Israel and Judah. Again, you can see this in Isaiah chapter 10, verses 5 through 6. However, their domination is temporary. God will eventually and does judge Assyria as well. And then you have the faithful remnant. Isaiah's prophecy only highlight a remnant of faithful believers who will survive the judgment and become the foundation for future restoration. Again, Isaiah chapter 10, verses 20 through 23, you can read it there again. And then you have the broader historical themes. The failure of human kings. The prophecy of Isaiah 9 underscores the inadequacies of human rulers like King Ahaz. The child describes in verse 6 through 7 represents the divinely appointed ruler who will bring true peace and justice. And then you have the hope of restoration. Isaiah's message of light breaking into darkness resonates with the longing for deliverance from political and spiritual oppression. I said a lot there. It's a lot to take in because there's so much happening pre-Isaiah 9. I mean, when I'm studying this and reading this, I'm like, how do I get all of that condensed into 700 words? I mean, I gave you like so many years of history in 700 words. It's a lot to take in. But let me encourage you. Go back. Read it. Because when you look at that verse, you're like, oh, that's a good verse. But do you realize how much light that verse gave such an extremely dark world? I mean, look around you right now. You're thinking, man, this room's a little dark. Think about how much darkness those people lived in. Think about you living in that pagan world. And Isaiah says, hey, let me give you a prophecy. Let me tell you about a guy that's going to come, and he's going to be Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Let me tell you about a guy. I don't know about you, but that gives me hope. And so Isaiah 9 reflects Judah's dire circumstances during the Assyrian threat and their spiritual decline. And amid this doom and gloom, Isaiah delivers this message full of hope. A future leader, will establish God's kingdom marked by justice and peace and righteousness. This prophecy would have offered immediate encouragement to Isaiah's contemporaries while also pointing to the ultimate fulfillment of the coming Messiah. And so as we are now today in the season of Advent, Isaiah's prophecy draws us to reflect on the names given to the Messiah: Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And so this morning we're gonna look at the first one, Wonderful Counselor, and how it brings comfort and guidance to our life. Point number one this morning: the meaning of Wonderful Counselor. The title Wonderful Counselor in Hebrew carries really a profound significance. Wonderful refers to something extraordinary. And so beyond human comprehension, it describes something that's miraculous, a marvel, right? Counselor refers to someone who offers wise guidance, a trusted advisor. And when I hear the term counselor, I think of someone you turn to when you need guidance. Someone you trust to provide sound advice. A counselor is an expert in their field, equipped to navigate you through specific challenges. For example, would you ask a mechanic to help you write a book? Chances are, probably not. Would you go to a baker to learn how to have heart surgery? Probably not. Would you go to a pastor to ask him for deer hunting techniques? Probably not. I mean, you could. Thanks, Clinton. When you're looking for wise counsel, you seek the right person. Someone who has expertise in the area that you need help. And so this is where Jesus comes into the picture as Wonderful Counselor. Jesus, as the Wonderful Counselor, is not just a good teacher or a wise guide. He is the miraculous divine source of wisdom and truth. His counsel for us transcends human understanding because he knows the depths of our hearts, the depths of our situations, and the path for us to perfection. But here's the deal. As I've mentioned before, and as Pastor Mark said during revival, when we go to God in prayer, guess what? He'll lead you. He'll guide you. He'll direct you. He provides that wise counsel when we desperately need it. But when we fail to seek his guidance, we become like what James 1:6 describes it as unsettled as a wave of the seas that's blown around and tossed by the wind. Have you ever been to the ocean during the storm? I have. Have you ever been to the ocean when you've seen a tropical storm or a hurricane coming on the shore? I have. Guess what? It's not fun. It's scary looking. I don't want to be there. It's rough. It's chaotic. Definitely not something that you want to face. That's why when you need guidance, you must follow the example of the verse prior to that. James 1:5 says, if you need wisdom, you ask our generous God, and he will give it to you. He will not rebuke you for asking. Seek him, and he will provide the wisdom that you need. Which leads us to the next point this morning. Jesus as the wonderful counselor in action. In the Gospels, we see Jesus living out this in action. He offered clarity to those in confusion, like Nicodemus in John chapter 3, explaining the new birth through the Spirit. Here Jesus explains to Nicodemus how to become a Christian and live an eternal life in the kingdom of heaven. At the start of the conversation, Nicodemus asked an honest and somewhat amusing question. If you go back and read it, you can go back and read it, but I'm going to read it for you. Because I'm in my office, I'm reading this, and I'm like, you know, if you're Jesus in this moment, Nicodemus asked this question, you look at it and you're like, what? Has anybody ever asked you a crazy question? I won't say stupid question because there is no stupid question. But has anybody ever asked you a question and you want to look at him and you're like, what in the world are you talking about? You ever had that? Thank you, young lady. You shook your head. I agree with you. Right. Yes. You look at him, you're like, you remember that old saying, Jeff Foxworthy? And he's like, he would just say, here's your sign. You know, sometimes, okay, so Jesus probably didn't do this, but like when you look at Nicodemus, you're like, what? Okay, here we go. Here's what he says. What do you mean, explained Nicodemus? How can an old man go back into his mother's womb and be born again? Okay, maybe you don't think that's funny. But if you're Jesus and you're like, look at Nicodemus, you're like, what? What are you talking about? This is John 3:4, by the way. And you're like, Nicodemus. You know, Nicodemus, like, he's like, well, I want to be born again. But like, you know, you're talking about that. I'd be saved. Like, whatever, you know. And Nicodemus is like, bro, I'm full grown. How am I going to? It makes no sense. You know? I mean, is that a crazy question to ask? I mean, if I was Nicodemus, I mean, I might have asked that question, but I might have wanted some more context from Jesus. But Jesus, I mean, it's easy to chuckle, it's easy to laugh when we read that, but from Nicodemus' perspective, it's a genuine attempt to really understand. But the key takeaway from this is that Nicodemus knew exactly where to go to, albeit at night. In the middle of the night, you know, he didn't want his posse to see where he was going in the middle of the night. But he knew where to go to. He knew to go straight to the horse's mouth to get the right answer. And so Jesus then gives him. Here's kind of how it goes, right? Jesus told him the answer, but Nicodemus asked an honest question because he knew where to go to. So Jesus, wonderful counselor, in action. How many of you go to Jesus when you have a legit comment, question, or concern? I see one shaking your head. Yeah, that's good. Thank you. But how many of you do it? Well, he can read my mind. Okay, I get that. But he wants you to ask. If you don't ask, how will he know? Is it like that in marriage too? I failed mind reading a long time ago. Don't just assume I can read your mind, right? If you want me to do something, then you have to ask. Am I right? Don't get mad. This is not between me and Ashley. So don't look at Ashley like, oh, you guys have marriage problems. This has nothing to do with Ashley. I'm just saying, and I'm just talking in general terms. Well, that pastor, he didn't come see me in the hospital. You didn't tell me. How am I supposed to know you're in the hospital if you don't communicate to me? Yeah. I can't read your mind. Well, Jesus doesn't either. If you don't tell him, he wants to hear you. He wants to be your wonderful counselor, but if you never go to him and talk, how in the world is he going to know that you need him to be your wonderful counselor? Well, I can take care of myself. No. You need him. You need his wisdom. You need his advice. You need him in your life. Have you ever tried to navigate life without Jesus? It is a train wreck. You need him in your life. And then we see it again. Jesus gave hope to the broken, like the woman at the well, offering her living water that would quench her soul's thirst. I don't know about you, but when I looked at this conversation and I loved it. And in verse 11, John chapter 4, verse 11. "But sir, you don't have a rope or a bucket," she said. "And this well is very deep. Where would you get this living water?" Verse 12. "And besides, do you think you're greater than our ancestors Jacob, who gave us this well? How can you offer better water than he and his sons and his animals enjoyed?" Verse 13, Jesus replied, "Anyone who drinks this water will soon become thirsty again. But those who drink the water I give will never be thirsty again. It becomes a fresh, bubbling spring within them, giving them eternal life." Verse 15, "Please, sir," the woman said, "give me this water. Then I'll never be thirsty again. I won't have to come here to get water." This woman was eager and deeply intrigued by this idea of the water that Jesus spoke about, likely interpreting it as purely in the literal sense of water. However, Jesus, in the profound wisdom, shifted the conversation to a deeper spiritual meaning, offering living water of eternal life. Fully aware of her story and her struggles, Jesus gently revealed his knowledge of her life circumstances, right? He knew about her history of her multiple husbands, which is why he asked her to bring her husband, leading to a pivotal moment of self-realization and grace. But what I love about this story the most, and this whole exchange, is in verses 25 through 26. And I'm going to be honest with you. The other day in my office, I felt like in that moment, the Lord just kind of came down to my office. Like almost like, you ever have those like those God moments that's like, ah, you know? Like you almost get overwhelmed. Like I had just tears of the Holy Spirit just kind of come on me. And this is what it says, verse 25. It was almost like Jesus like, whoo, watch this. He goes, phew. He threw it out there. He's like, watch this. He's like, yeah, watch this. And this is what he does. The woman said, "I know the Messiah is coming, the one who is called Christ. When he comes, he will explain everything to us." 26, you ready? Then he's told her, "I am the Messiah." I don't know about you. That got me worked up. Can you imagine in that moment? That lady sitting there, she's like, "Hey, I can't wait." Man, when the Messiah comes, he looked to her stone cold face and says, "I am. I am the Messiah." I don't know about you. I would have fell straight to my feet. Looking at it like, I don't know. But man, I read that the other day, and I felt that my heart just went crazy. And it does right now. That he is the Messiah. He is the Wonderful Counselor. And he loves you. And he is for you. That no matter, look at that woman in the well, no matter her life circumstances, he still went to her and he says, "I am for you and I want to give you everything. I want to give you eternal life. I want to give you something that will never, ever make you thirsty again. And I've got it for you. And I am the Messiah." And guess what? That little baby is that same guy. That same person. It's incredible. It's mind-blowing. You know, man, it's been no secret, man. My family has faced so much adversity these last 6 months. But you know what gives me hope? He is the Messiah. I'm standing here today because he came. He is the Messiah. That gives me hope. Another example. It's getting warm up here. Another example. Another one of my all-time favorite stories in the New Testament. Jesus offered direction to the lost as seen in the story of Zacchaeus. Wee little man was he. He climbed up in the sycamore tree for all he wanted to see. Y'all know that story? Y'all know that song? That's right. Zacchaeus in Luke chapter 9, calling him out into a transformed life. I've read this story, I don't know how many times. I've done it, I don't know how many times in kids' church, you know. And, you know, when I read this story again, I read in verse 5, it said this. When Jesus came by, he looked up at Zacchaeus and called him by name. Zacchaeus, he said, quick, come down. I must be a guest at your home today. When I looked at that, for all my years, I was like, sweet, he's going over to have a potluck. I wonder if he likes chicken and dumplings. And then I thought about it. Maybe I look at this and maybe I'm completely wrong. And if I am, I'm okay with that. Quick, I must be a guest in your house today. He needed to be a guest spiritually in his house. You see, maybe you're like, Pastor Brian, you've been a pastor for like a lot of years, and I've known that like 40 years. You're probably right. But see, maybe it's because you get so used to looking at Scripture, and you read it so many times, and you just look over it, and you don't sometimes get it. Does that make sense? And I looked at that, and I'm like, growing up, I just looked at it, like, oh, see, Jesus is going to his house today. Yeah, no. He's like, Zacchaeus, it's time for you to stop messing around. It's time for you to stop being crooked. It's time for you to come down out of that tree, stop acting like an idiot, and get your heart right. You've played the part way too long. You've done so many crooked things to so many people. Just think what it would look like if you would give your life to me. What would that look like, Zacchaeus? If you would stop stealing money and being an evil tax collector, if you would just turn your life around. What would that look like? Instead of all these people getting mad at me because I'm going to your house, because they did, what would it look like? Despite being that wealthy tax collector who had cheated many people, Zacchaeus is like, awesome, let's do it. Excited, eager, doesn't hesitate. It says he climbed down. He could have jumped down, for all we know. But while Zacchaeus was filled with joy around, the crowd grumbled. You remember Pastor Mark talking about that word grumbled? Right? I remember. It says they grumbled. They were mad. You ever thought about why they were so upset that they were mad Jesus was going to Zacchaeus' house? I've always wondered that. But they were judging Jesus for associating himself with a known sinner. Yet, once they were in his home, Zacchaeus showed repentance. And in verse 8, he declares this, I will give half my wealth to the poor, Lord. And if I have cheated people in their taxes, I will give them back four times as much. So in response, Jesus shows grace and compassion, saying in verse 9, salvation has come to this home today, for this man has shown himself to be true son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save those who are lost. You see, this powerful moment reminds us that Jesus knows. Jesus knows our hearts, sees our potential for change, and meets us where we are, offering redemption to those who truly seek him. You see, I believe these three examples, we see Jesus as the wonderful counselor in action. His wisdom transcends human limitations. He sees what we cannot and leads us with eternal and perfect perspective. The truth should fill us with hope today. Not just as it brought hope to the people in Isaiah's time. So no matter what challenges that we're facing, he sees our struggles. And he offers us guidance and hope in the midst of what we're going through. Number three this morning, the once wonderful counselor in our lives today. We see in Psalms 86:10, David praises God for his greatness and his marvelous deeds. These marvelous deeds include the wisdom and counsel that he provides. Jesus is still our wonderful counselor today. He understands our struggles. We see in Hebrews 4:15 reminds us that Jesus is our high priest who understands our weakness. He knows our fears and our doubts and our pain. It might seem like the challenges we face today are not compared to what they could have endured back then. Or maybe you feel like it's gotten much worse, and we sometimes feel like that. But as you dive into Scripture, you'll see that much of what we encounter today, they faced back then as well. Sure, it might look a little different on the surface, but the struggles are strikingly similar. But here's the good news today. Jesus knows, and guess what? He sees you. He's right there with you through every single trial, every twist, and every turn on this roller coaster that we call life. And it's comforting to know that we have the greatest counselor there is. It's comforting to know that he's there 24/7. Right? We don't have to call and get on Google Calendar and make an appointment. Right? We don't have to call our insurance to make sure that he takes our insurance. Guess what? He does. He's always there. We don't have to pay a deductible, praise the Lord. That deductible, guess what? It was paid. It was paid on the cross for you. And he's there to listen to you every time that you need help. He guides us in truth. In John 16:13, it says, Jesus promises the Spirit of truth will guide us in all truth. Through his word and spirit, he continues to counsel us. His truth will continue to counsel you as long as you're willing to receive it. To experience his wisdom and guidance, you must pray daily and make seeking him your top priority. He is your top priority after all. If you don't ask, guess what? He can't answer. It reminds me when people tell me, that counselor didn't help me. I went to him a couple times and they didn't help me. My response to them is the same. Did you communicate what you were dealing with? A counselor can only help you as much as you're willing to share. If you hold back, guess what? They can't address the needs that you have. The same with Jesus. Make sure that you're fully opening up your heart and communicating with him, sharing everything that you're going through, opening every single aspect of your heart. After all, he is the best counselor. He's ready to guide you. But guess what? Communication is key. He offers peace and uncertainty. Philippians 4:6-7 teaches us to bring our anxieties. We talked about this last week to God. And he will give us peace that surpasses understanding. As the wonderful counselor, Jesus invites us to trust him with our burdens. Number four this morning, responding to the wonderful counselor. What should our response be to such a counselor? Number one, to seek his guidance. Instead of turning to the world's wisdom, we should look first to Jesus in prayer. Scripture says in Psalms 86:11, teach me your way, Lord, that I may rely on your faithfulness. Give me an undivided heart that I may fear your name. Number two, trust his plan. His ways may not always make sense to us. Trust me, it's true. But a proverb that we all know, Proverbs 3:5-6 says this. Do you know what it is? You know Proverbs 3:5-6? Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding, but in all your ways submit or acknowledge him, and he will what? Direct, make your path straight, right? It doesn't say, trust in Brian, trust in Carl, trust in Dion, trust in Jack, trust in Jesse. Doesn't say that. Doesn't say trust in Clinton. It says trust in the Lord. Trust in the Lord with all. Not a quarter. Not a half. Not 5/8. Not 7/8. Not 9/16. Doesn't say that. It says all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. But in all your ways acknowledge Him. Number three is share your counsel, share His counsel. The wisdom of Jesus is not just for you and for me. It's for the world. As His followers, we are called to reflect His truth and love to others, pointing them to the ultimate source of guidance and hope. You see, this morning Isaiah's prophecy reminds us that the child born in Bethlehem is more than a baby in a manger. He is our wonderful counselor, the one who knows us fully, loves us deeply, and guides us perfectly. As we celebrate this, as we celebrate really the beginning today of the Christmas season, let us rest in His wisdom, trust His guidance, worship Him with marvelous deeds as He continues to do in our life. This morning, I was down there praying before I came up. And this morning I want to end in prayer. We're going to play some music, and I just feel like we're going to open these altars just for however long the Lord leads. This morning, maybe as we enter this season, maybe you need to seek the wonderful counselor this morning. And the best way to do that is to understand that He has good plans for you. He does. He has wonderful plans for you. He has great plans for you. Maybe this Christmas season is hard for you. Maybe there's some tough times that you're facing. I don't know. But I just feel in my heart that I want to open up these altars this morning. Because I want you to know that He is a wonderful counselor. That no matter what you're facing, no matter what you're going through, the best place to be is on your knees praying and seeking Him. As one of my previous pastors had told me, this baby that came in that manger, He came to bear your burdens, your hurts, your thoughts, everything. He came for you. That's why He came. So no matter what you're facing today, you have that one baby in that manger that loves you and that is for you. And that shows you favor as we sing today out of Numbers. If you feel like you need to come, come. Well, I'm going to pray. Well, I'm just going to, I won't hold long, but if you feel like you want to come, come. Lord Jesus, we love You today. We are so thankful for who You are and what You are doing. Lord, You are that wonderful counselor. And it's so assuring to know that You are the Messiah. That no matter what we face, no matter what we're going through, no matter who we think is against us, or the circumstances that are in our life, that are seemingly overwhelming at times, that we seem like what seems like all the walls are like closing in on us. Now, Lord, you are faithful. And you are sovereign. And God, we know that this holiday season is so commercialized that, and all the stresses that come from every single angle of having to get this gift and that gift and having to make sure we make this family member happy or that family member happy. And if we don't go to see that family, then that family member will be unhappy. And it's just so much crazy dynamics, Lord, that we seemingly lose focus of what this season's about. And Lord, ultimately, this season is about you. And it's the beginning of your story coming into this world as a Savior, Lord. And Lord, that you are that wonderful counselor, everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And Lord, I'm so thankful that you are reminding me, even in this season as we started, God, that you are faithful and that you are this reason. Lord, that I myself needed that remembrance of why we are doing this. And Lord, I am thankful that even as I sat in that office, Lord, and I read that scripture that I have read so many times, that woman, she says, we're waiting for when the Messiah comes. And you said, Lord, that I am the Messiah. Lord, I am thankful for that reminder that, Lord, you are that guy. And Lord, that you are that person that went to that cross for me. But Lord, we don't have the cross unless you come as you did as this infant. Lord, that Lord, you sent your son, Lord, as we came into this earth, born as a baby. Lord, I know there's people in this sanctuary right now, and maybe they didn't come for whatever reason, and that's okay. They're dealing with things in their life that you need to work out. But God, may they be open and willing to say, Lord, I need you. I need you to help me. Lord, if they don't, then you can't. Lord, have them put their selfish desires and their selfish thoughts and their selfish wills aside and take your will, because your will is perfect for their life. Lord, that's what we need. Lord, I pray that, Lord, you would transform our church this holiday season. Help us to focus on what you want this season, not what we want. Lord, let us put all that commercial stuff aside and, Lord, let us focus on you. Lord, it seems like that we are almost living in that time of Isaiah chapter 9 of spiritual darkness. And Lord, we need that hope, that light to break through. We need that right now so desperately. And Lord, that verse right now gives us hope. Lord, that you are. Lord, come in this place. Fill us today with your Spirit, Lord. Help us just to open our hearts to hear what you want. Lord, have your way. Lord, today, more than ever, we need you. Lord, I pray for the people that are represented around this altar right now, God. I pray that you would hear them. I pray that you would hear their needs. I pray that you would answer them according to your will, your perfect will. I pray that you would show them favor, that you would show them blessings. Lord, help us today, Lord God. Lord, we pray all this today, Lord, in your mighty name. Amen and amen. Church, I love you. I am praying for you like I always do. But I want you to remember this. Remember why we're here this Christmas season. Because Jesus is. Jesus is wonderful counselor, mighty God, everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Jesus is. I pray you have a great week. As always, I pray you stay warm. And we will see you Wednesday night for breakfast. Is that right? This Wednesday? Kingdom Builders will be back on Wednesday. Okay. I missed you guys. All right. Know that you're loved and you'll be missed this week. That's all I got. I hope you have a great week. See ya.